Thank you. Well, on behalf of the musicians of the Symphonic Band, allow me to thank you for being here with us this evening for this, our final regular concert of the semester. I'm not sure where October went, let alone November, but here we are, the week before Thanksgiving. We're delighted to be in this gorgeous space here on our campus to share music with you this evening. Those of you who were here for the first part of our program this evening have the opportunity to meet a guest composer who has been on our campus this week, and we are about to finish our program with a composition of his. I should share with you that his residency here was made possible through a grant by our Council on Student Affairs. Symphonic Band is a registered student organization here, and we are grateful for our Council on Student Affairs to make grants available to make events like this possible. So thank you to them and that entity here on our campus. James, yes, appropriate to share. It's a rich experience anytime we have to bring in, have the opportunity to bring an internationally renowned musician and artist, and in this case, composer, to our campus. So to share with you a little bit about this composition, which for many of you will probably be a first-time experience hearing this piece, I'd like to invite to the podium and the microphone here the person who can share with you perhaps most profoundly what it is that you're about to take in. Would you welcome to the microphone composer James Stephenson.
I'm so happy that I also get this opportunity to thank Scott Jones for being just a wonderful host, having me here literally cooking for me, and just providing an atmosphere that's full of learning and curiosity and acceptance for a guy from Chicago flying in for a few days, and just treating me with a lot of respect and caring and kindness. So that will never be lost on me, and I've really enjoyed my time here, and so thank you, Scott, for that. Brent earlier mentioned on the first half that I think he said something that I was a prolific composer, and the piece you're about to hear, however, is one I wish I never had to have written, and frankly, I wish it would not have a reason to be played anymore, which is something that composers don't always say about their music. This piece was written after the shooting in Charleston in 2015. Even back then, we were all saying, could these please stop? I can't believe it's happening again. And here we are 4 years later, and we're still saying those words. And when that happened in Charleston, I have a history in Charleston. I traveled there many times, working with the orchestra, working with friends, playing there as a trumpet player. I've played there several times. And so when the one happened in Charleston, it really hit me hard. And I sent a message out on Facebook just saying, if there's anything a composer can do, let me know. And a young conductor in Charleston wrote me back immediately and said, Jim, are you serious? Maybe we can do something and make something happen. And so through a series of events, 2 months later, we were able to organize a concert in August where members of the victims' families were invited, and it was kind of a collage concert with a gospel singer and jazz group, and we ended up with the piece you're about to hear. And the beautiful thing about it, if I can say that about an event like that, was that all the musicians who traveled to Charleston also saw my plea out on Facebook and said, hey, I'd love to come. They responded, so I'd love to come play it. And, you know, so everybody just traveled from far away to Charleston to take part in this concert out of the goodness of their hearts, which I thought was amazing. So, you know, how does a composer write a piece about something like that that happens? And for me, it was important just to respond to it with my own internalization of what had happened, but also to do my best to pay tribute to the nine victims equally and with as much respect as I possibly could. And so I did research on them and just sort of let go of myself and let the music go where it will, where it would. And so for me, it was a five-stage process. And I want to just tell you that at the beginning, you will hear very quickly the violent act itself. I felt it was important to put that in there and then just get it out of the way. So that's the first thing you will hear, and then you will hear shock, as if you were in the Bible study, if you were in the room and you can't believe this just happened, and you just sit there and how could this possibly have happened? So that is musically represented. Then we have sadness, which I think is something we can all relate to, and anger, another thing we can all relate to. And then finally, the most important thing for me with that event was the forgiveness that happened almost immediately afterward from the families to the perpetrator. And so in representing the forgiveness, again, I wanted to treat the nine victims equally. And you will hear a melody get repeated nine times. And the way this melody was constructed, I had read a poem by the poet laureate of Charleston. She had dedicated to the victims, and it was stanza, stanza, stanza. And the middle stanza was simply the victims' names. Just 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and then more writing. And it was that middle stanza that really stuck out to me. And so the melody that you will hear repeated nine times at the end of the piece is those names set to music. And it's actually in their parts too, so they know what they're playing. They see the names right below the notes that they're playing. And I've asked Carter if you wouldn't mind just giving a demo of that melody so that you can know what to listen for, because it happens first in euphonium. So if you wouldn't mind allowing Carter to demonstrate that for us. So when that melody is playing, you'll hear a single stroke on a chime when that victim's name is a part of that melody. So you'll hear a single stroke, and I like to think of that as, you know, we have the terrible tragedy at the beginning in the Bible study. It's ugly, it's not pretty, it's something we want to forget. When you hear those chime strokes, I'd invite you to think about maybe the victims have gone somewhere else from that terrible room that they were once in on that fateful night, and then now we're sending them somewhere else. I would invite you, if you don't mind, I'm going to stop talking, but I would invite you as we start this piece to, if you don't mind, just imagine yourself, whether you're religious or not, maybe just imagine you're in a quiet room, you're in a Bible study, and then this thing happens. Okay, so whether that means closing your eyes or just being quiet, I want you to feel the effect of it and then allow yourself to be transported to wherever the music takes you. So again, thank you, Scott. Thank you to all the musicians, because being with them has enriched my life more than they'll ever know. And thank you to the university for having me. So I invite you to experience There Are No Words.